We had both technical difficulties and traffic was not on our side, and the crazy commuters and discourteous drivers, and I'm blaming everything except myself, because generally that's the source of my problems. But I'm here now, and I'm ready to get episode number 17 off the ground. An episode for my numerology cats. Episode 17 means what? 1 and 7. And what is 1 and 7 in the numerological, astrological significance? That's 1 and a 7 come together with 8. When you turn that number 8 to the left or to the right, you get the infinity symbol. Right? Deep, right? Nah, this ain't that kind of show. I'm sorry. But it's fun to pretend, right? I mean, there's some cats that live by that numerology stuff and astrology. But I guess the world is a horrible, scary, and dysfunctional place. So any type of escape, any type of relief, either real or artificial, chemical or natural, people are going to gravitate to it. So if you can come up with some type of ideology or philosophy or analysis that can provide relief, psychological, emotional, or even physical relief to the masses of people, you're going to have a very, very large following. Whether you want to be a guru or a nationalist leader, whatever you call it. It's a lot harder to rally people if you're strictly on some nationalist, rational analysis type stuff and practical, pragmatic action. Because traumatized people tend to remain in what you call their limbic brain, their reptilian brain, the more immediate satisfaction. They want immediate turnaround, whereas people that are more in their frontal lobes, you know, their cerebrums, they're more rational, so to speak. Now, I'm not a Vulcan. I don't call for absolute rationality, and I don't call for reactionary emotionalism either. I think that both of those qualities have survived our evolutionary development or were created in us by the almighty intelligent designer, whatever your orientation is. But we've come this far as the chosen people, as the created people, or as an evolved primates, however you classify humanity at this point over our development. We come this far with the capacity for emotionalism, deep-seated feelings, for wondrous imaginations and capacity for fantasy to make the unreal real, and married to the ability for very critical long-term memory and thinking and rationalization. So what you have, the best of all worlds, really. We really have that option where we can fuse the two. And that's not even what I intended to talk about. But I tried to do some corny, I admit, numerology joke. But this is show episode. I don't know what to call them. Show, episodes, program. Episode. I like episodes, so I'll just go with episode. Number 17. 1-8. 1-7. To the 8. Infinity symbol. That means the show will go on forever. Or until they cut me off. I'm fired. Or the funds dry up. Whichever comes first. But then when it's over, I'll say it's because I'll come up with some other spooky, hooky, spooky numerological reason for it to end. So, there's a way through everything. Anyway, I don't know. I'm trying to inject some levity because the show today, I want to talk about, and again, the broken record, the subtitle or the unofficial name of this show. It's the Broken Record Show. Because this is a show that deals with the Pan-African perspective on all things, not just the plight of African people, but the standing and motivations and agendas of our oppressors, of other non-African oppressed people and non-African, non-European oppressors, economics, ecology, labor, politics, history, academia, formal learning and informal learning. This is a show, parenting, love, sex, This is a show that deals with everything, but from a Pan-Africanist conscious perspective. But it seems like I have to keep revisiting the issues of violence. Whether it's descending violence, which is violence coming from the elites against the masses of the people, violence coming from the established, quote-unquote, legitimate institutions against the masses of the people. That's descending violence, violence coming from top down. Whether it's lateral violence, which means people who are equal status on the hierarchy imposing violence on each other. You know, whether that doesn't matter if it's two impoverished black males shooting it out in the street. Whether it's a man at home beating his wife, a poor man at home beating his wife, or a poor single mother abusing her children. There's a new video of a mother who assaults her child and beats her child viciously and literally throws him into the streets. Because apparently, because she did not receive a child support payment. And she took the anger out on a very small child, looked to be 3 to 4 years old. And that's actually descending violence, but it's also an element of lateral violence because you have a black woman who's very obviously at the bottom areas of the social strata. And then you have a child that's only slightly lower than her. So depending on how you assess that assault, that crime, it could be both lateral and descending. But it's more lateral violence than descending violence. And then you have ascending violence, which is rare, but it happens. Which is people at the lower on the social hierarchy, on the power hierarchy, on the social people that matter, their lives matter the least, engaging in violence against those higher on the hierarchy. And we had the two shooters, you know, the brother in Louisiana and the brother in Texas. That's ascending violence. The prison uprising, prison rebellions, the recent Milwaukee rebellion, and Cleveland rebellion. I mean, you could throw a dart at the map of the United States, and you more likely than not will hit an area that has experienced an uprising and rebellion. But though that is actually the rarest form of violence. The most common form of violence is descending violence of the elites and their agents, their officers, their henchmen against the masses. That is the most common and pervasive form of violence, but it's just not identified. That type of violence doesn't get reported as violence. It doesn't get recognized as a crime because it has been legalized, because it's institutionalized, and it's protected violence. And we are taught that type of violence, the violence and the constant threat that the elites have on us is to actually protect us. But our protectors are our greatest threat. Those armed officers, those legitimate protectors, those family service people, social workers, politicians, corporate leaders, bankers, the people who are there, the pillars of society, the backbone of society, are actually the greatest threat to the society. And if you look over histories at social collapse, societies that have imploded, more societies have been taken down by their so-called elites or the agendas of their elites, the greed of their elites, the corruption of their elites than have ever been taken down by the criminal element of a society. But then the second most pervasive or the second most prevalent form of violence is the lateral violence. People on the same level of the social hierarchy, generally in the middle and bottom areas, doing violence with people that are the same. And that's just logistical violence as well. If somebody's going to flip out and engage in crime, engage in violence in their community, engage in exploitation of other people, 9 times out of 10, it's going to be someone who is in closest proximity to them. You know, it's like Dick Gregory said, I flip out and my wife pissed me off. I'm not going to jump in my car and drive to the other side of town. I'm not going to jump in my car and drive to the northwest suburbs and shoot a stockbroker, a commodities trader. I'm going to walk out the front door and the first person to look at me wrong is going to catch it. And since, you know, we are segregated, that's something we got to talk about. Black people's obsession with being segregated. How come when we black people are amongst black people, we're segregated? But when you, we never call white people segregated. You can have an all-white community with all white clouds in the skies and white picket fences and white porcelain countertops and just a white, bland, soulless, you know, mayonnaise. And the only color in the whole community could be their Nutella. And we never call them segregated. When black people, when we are either forced or by choice to be amongst each other exclusively, we're segregated. But nobody says Chinatown is segregated. Nobody talks about integrating Chinatown. You know? And when we talk about integrations, it's always, when we move into their communities, it's integration. When they come to our communities, it's gentrification. And then we always talk about white flight as well. But what about black flight? You know how many people in my hood got a little something, little degree, little job, little title, little status, little talent that got them up out of there and they left? I mean, a much bigger concern to me is black flight. But that's not the topic. And I'm just saying this, the calling this the broken record show is because we have to keep returning to this issue of violence. And not even because, as bad as the violence is, it's not the primary issue. You know, and even in terms of black livelihood, black health and well-being, violence and homicide is not the top killer of black folks. And if you were to define the most deadliest weapons in the hood, it's the fork, spoon, and steak knife, not guns. You know, heart disease, cardiovascular disease, cancer, adult onset diabetes, which we can't even call adult onset diabetes, adult onset anymore. When I was in school studying human pathology and disease processes, they used to call it adult onset diabetes. But then they started calling it type 2 diabetes because 12-year-olds were developing adult onset. It used to be the average age of a person to develop adult onset diabetes was, mid-50s, between 53 and 55. And that was just as recent as the 80s and 90s, early 90s. But now you have 3-year-olds developing adult onset diabetes because of their diets, high processed and refined sugars and high processed and refined carbohydrates, in addition to little to no exercise. And a big part of that little to no exercise, especially in certain major cities, is children can't go out to play because the streets are too dangerous. So that's really what I want to talk about. Chicago has had, day before yesterday, had its 3,000th, with the TH, 3,000th shooting, and is on trajectory to more than double the homicides if things keep at a pace from just last year. And these type of numbers aren't new. At the height of the crack epidemic, these are the kind of numbers we had when the crack epidemic was kicked off. And I want to talk, having been in Chicago, having organized in Chicago, I want to talk about my personal experience in Chicago and some of my conclusions. And again, these aren't expert conclusions. These aren't even studied conclusions. Even though I have some of those, these are more personal. From my own interactions with the city is what I want to talk about. What has brought the Chicago to these levels of homicide? What has brought us here? What sustains us here? And what are some ways out of this? That's what I want to deal with after another short musical break. I'm sorry about the late start. I'm sorry about the disruption. And I'm sorry if you're experienced. You can call me or social media me if there are any issues on your side. I think I've got everything fixed on my side. But again, let me know. 312-985-7834. After a brief musical break, we will return to discuss just the violence in Chicago. And in particular, but violence in Black America as in as a whole. So please enjoy this another classic by KRS. And I'll be back on the flippy trip.
with their Nutella.
Say what?
The only color is their Nutella. How did you know about white people and Nutella?
I live in America. Nobody ever called. Well, the trip and hunt goes like the Ho Chi Minh Trail. We got the truth, daddy. Last emperor KRS in. History manifested. With tomorrow the next lesson. What you be doing that?
You know the cops, they got an infiltrate toxic rock.
So get that flashlight out of my face. What you be selling crap? What you be doing that? I'm kind of wondering if there's a limit on things. If I could just keep that going. We had music breaks, so this is off air. This is behind the scenes type stuff, so don't expect it. This is what I do when the music is playing. I kind of just put it in my phone. No, I like the music, though. And then I look at my notes here. Show y'all some behind the scenes type, real insider type stuff. Can't read it. This is where the magic happens. All my notes, all my manic, ranting, feverish, ranting. So that's insider stuff. You know, I review my notes. Sometimes I'll have books to reference. So that's what happens during the music break. But I don't know if y'all can hear the music break. I put the headphones on the thing, huh? Oh, you can call in. Oh, yeah. My wife is here behind the scenes trying to tell me how to do my job. Darcy blows. I don't know if she thinks it's funny. Oh, and that's why I was late. So. Imposters.
Give them a number. Would you give the number if they call in?
I'm not on the air. I'll give the number when I go back on the air. Do I come to your job and kick gum out of your mouth? Do I come to your job and knock books out of your hand? Do I come to your job and bore your students? Gosh. Oh my God, it's mother, you can fix this. We rock over mixes, not 666s. It's time to share it. To unite with all the players. All right, CIA, KRS-One, KRS-One, the last emperor, and you know who the other guy was?
I have no idea.
Zach De La Roach. Lord have his mercy. That was Zach De La Roach with Rage Against the Machine, the scream rock rapper. I don't know what it's called, but I've always been a fan, way back. Since way back, I've always been a big fan of Rage Against the Machine, but they're not a very prolific group. They don't tour very much. They don't put out very many albums. I don't think they really get along with each other. You know, that's how creatives are, though. I have a friend who's a creative. His name is King Dita. Oh, I have another friend who's a creative, Aline Marcus, who made the Bro Diallo Show, official hat of the Bro Diallo Show. And everybody that works for me, they work for shout outs. But that's not my fault. Anyway, again, this ain't nothing nice. Let's talk about Chicago violence. It is plagued by violence. And one component of Chicago violence is that Chicago violence gets coverage. And again, I'm not trying to be insensitive to the life loss. And as I stated before, for every life that's lost, there's dozens of people who are physically injured, crippled, and scarred by gunfire, violence, there's assault. So there's a epidemic of homicides, but there is a pandemic of physical violence and injury and scars that can last a lifetime. And for every individual that's shot and killed, there are dozens of individuals who are shot and injured. And for every dozens of individuals shot and injured, there are literally hundreds and thousands who are psychologically scarred. Generations of people. You know, but black community, black lives don't matter. So if there's a massive shooting or ongoing social disruption within the white community, they bring in professionals. They set aside resources in the budget to specifically not just deal with the physical, but with the psychological and emotional trauma. They shut down the schools. They have national days of mourning. The president will jump in Air Force One and run to Connecticut or run to whatever scene. He will immediately speak on it. You know, but for black folks, it's kind of like it's the standard. We've never been safe in this country. We've never been secure in this country. We've never been free of not just violence, because, again, even in the U.S. Criminal Code, active violence, but the very threat of violence is also considered violence. You could threaten someone with violence and they will prosecute you as though you have engaged in violence, because the psychological threat of violence, some people say the psychological scars run deeper and are much more difficult to heal than the physical scars. So we've never had a day of mourning, a day of atonement, and we've never had psychological or material reparations for our scars. So what you see is a perpetual ongoing assault, perpetual ongoing violence. It may manifest in different ways. It may go from the whip to the musket to the machine gun to the remote control bombs that they drop, you know. And when we get too far out of line, like Christopher Darner, who took up arms against his employers, and that he was actually the first man, black man, killed by remote control, killed by robot in the U.S., not the brother in Texas. He was actually number two. So, and what's really ironic about that is both of these guys were on opposite sides of the political ideological spectrum. One guy was RBG, black nationalist separatist. Another guy was an aggressive integrationist pro-system. In fact, he went on a shooting spree because he was not allowed to join the police force. He was not allowed to participate in the systems and institutions of oppression the way he felt that he deserved. So, but either way you can get it, whether you're submitting to the system and you fully embrace the system, or whether you reject the system and institutions. Either way, if you're black, you're black. You know, and you can't educate, earn, or spend your way out of that. We can only organize for revolution. But Chicago violence in particular, and black violence in general. One thing we can go back to at the height of this latest manifestation of violence, of street violence, gang violence, because we've always, you go all the way back to, let me check the time, okay. You go all the way back to the plantation. You had this phenomenon, or this persona that I called the plantation buck. And the plantation buck was the tend to be the strong slave, the aggressive slave, who during the day when it was time to pick cotton, when it was time to deforest, when it was time to tend to master's livestock and his other enterprises. This guy, you had some that were diligent, hard workers, others that were slackers and would just try to get by. But the main characteristic that united all the plantation bucks was that when the Africans were allowed, when our ancestors were allowed to retire to their quarters, that's when they would turn on. They would terrorize the other slaves. They never offered any resistance to the master. They were never any direct or immediate threat to the master or those who officially served the master, the slave drivers, the paddy rollers, the head slaves. But they reserved all of their aggression, all of their criminality, all of their violence were for other slaves. So they would try to reserve for them within the slave culture, within the slave system. They would use their physical strength and their aggression to secure the best status for themselves within that system. They didn't want to upend that system. They would not join in efforts to destroy the slave system. They would just seek the best position within the current status quo. And often the only tools available for them, because particular slaves, like there was the concept of that I learned about from the history, but actually Claude Anderson was the one who brought this phenomenon back to the surface, called meritorious manumission, which means the particularly talented enslaved Africans, the ones who had a particular skill, ones who had gone above and beyond just meeting their cotton quota or diligently going about their forced labor. But those who saved white people's lives, that invented an instrument or a methodology to increase their profits or increase the comfort of white people. Those who prevented threats or thwarted threats to the status quo, they would get what you call meritorious manumission, which means they would earn their freedom. They would still be subordinate to white, but they would be above all other blacks, and they would essentially be freemen. And you could earn this status. So if you were particularly talented, and you know, the Africans were not just picking cotton. They were engaged in carpentry, industry, you know, even artistic pursuits, playing the fiddle, and then you had the black athletes. The movie with Tarantino and Jamie Foxx, Django, the D is silent. Django was highlighted the fighting circuit, you know, the professional fighting circuit, if you have. So there were the liberated slaves, and then under that you had everybody else, and let's come all the way back to the plantation book. So that's nothing new. African individuals who dwelled in oppressive spaces, but instead of fighting against the oppression, they tried to use that space, that isolated, that secluded, that oppressive space to glean whatever benefits they could. And if their method of securing extra benefit, extra resources, extra bucket of chili, extra scraps of clothing for themselves, meaning that they had to brutalize other black people, they had to compound the oppression of other black people, they were more than willing to do it. So that goes all the way back then, the so-called black-on-black violence. But if you understand that all of that happened within a container, within a social structure created and sustained by the whites, and the ones who ultimately profited from that disruption, because the plantation bucks, they were very disruptive to unity. They were very disruptive to cooperation. Therefore, they were very disruptive to any organized or coordinated efforts to overthrow the system or to escape the system or to better endure or more functionally endure the system. So the plantation buck then, or the so-called black-on-black criminal, black thug, black gangster now, it's the same phenomenon. But at different eras, certain attention is paid. Sometimes you go through, the society will have what they had come to term in the 70s, benign neglect. And benign neglect meant that the society was saying, listen, we're not even going to pretend to give that we care about what's going on with the blacks in the inner cities, the poor blacks. If you're not Sammy Davis Jr., if you're not Muhammad Ali, if you're not a black person who can bring an immense profit to us, who can help promote the American way of life and the idea of American democracy around the globe during the Cold War, then you really don't matter, and we're sick of kind of pretending. You know, go your own way. And what the police are tasked with in our community is not ending violence. not ending crime. They're tasked with containing crime. As long as it doesn't bleed into the white areas. As long as it doesn't bleed over into the economic areas. So they contain the violence, and then there's certain enclaves where crime has to be subdued. Because there are parasites in our community. Multinational corporations and small business owners who set up shop to give us substandard service and toxic products. The little gas stations, bodegas in the hood. So the police offer direct and immediate protection for those enclaves of extraction, I call them. And everybody else, you do what you want. We'll come in and sweep up the mess. We're not going to prevent, do any intervention. We're not going to do anything to subdue. In fact, we're going to create and sustain conditions that will definitely provoke violence. But we're not going to do anything to intercede on that. We'll just come in and sweep up. After the shooting is done, after the damage is done, after the bodies pile up, we'll come in and throw some of the perpetrators into the prison industrial complex. We'll come in and harass, which also, you know, and treat people in dehumanizing ways, which will increase their personal angst and aggression. So my main point in this is that this is an ongoing cycle. I know you step out of your front door and you're seeing a shot up car, which I've done. I've walked my dog through my community and I've seen cars riddled with bullet holes just moments before I got there. You know, I mean, there's literally been nights I've hooked up with friends to go out to the club at night, and on the way home, I see a stabbing victim or a shooting victim there in the street, and we do what we can, you know. So that seeing that immediately, you're not going to be in a position to think, well, you know, there's a larger historical context for all this. And I don't expect people to, but in the times that we do have to reflect on this, we really need to. Because unless you get a complete understanding, a proper diagnosis of the disease, you cannot implement the proper treatment plan. You will not know what particular solutions or cures to implement. Even if you have a whole bucket full of solutions, unless you properly diagnose specifically what the problem is, you won't know which solution. And for some, just like in the medical field, you know, medicines that will cure cancer will advance other diseases. And not just medicines or chemicals, but herbs. Certain herbs in some conditions can save your life. Other conditions and circumstances, they will poison you. So you need a proper diagnosis. So I'm not telling people that are on the front lines. When you're on the front line, it's about survival. It's about executing the agenda. But then for every battle, as I say, the Pentagon has more lecture halls and classrooms than it does gun ranges, you know. And for every gun range, they have a West Point where they do intensive academic study. So in a conflict, in a high risk areas, you still need your intellectual work. And so my point is that there, all of the, what we're seeing today, is not about young people deciding not to be good people. It's not about young folks deciding, hey, I don't want to go to school, I don't want to be a productive member of society, I want to be antisocial. I want to kill the next man. You know, this is a long, consistent pattern in history that has not only been predicted, but it has been constructed and guided and directed. Amos Wilson tells us, and we have to always remember this, if you want to understand a persistent, very stubborn social problems that just can't seem to be overcome, that just seem to pop up at certain times in history, and there's just no solutions, and no matter all the good work all people are doing, they just don't seem to make a dent. When you want to look at that, you have to say, who profits from these issues? Who's profiting from these problems? Not who's suffering. If you look at who's suffering, then that will give you a lot of insights on the fallout, on the outcomes of the issue, but it will give you very little insights about where it comes from and how it's being sustained and perpetuated. And a lot of times when people only focus on the victims of the problems, they tend to start blaming the victims. And yes, the shooters, the gangsters, the thugs, the gangbangers are as much victims as their targets. And the only difference between the shooter and the shootee, the guy in the prison and the guy on the ground, a lot of times the only thing dividing the two is who was quicker to the draw. You know. And a lot of these guys will say, I had to get him before he got me. And it's not even that I wanted to do this. It's like, it's a survival mechanism. So where did that come from? You have to look at the historical line. And one thing everybody will say, when I talk to people in Chicago upon arriving here about 6 years ago, a lot of people will say, yeah, when they took out Fred Hampton, things were getting better under Fred Hampton. Fred Hampton was awakening the gangbangers. Fred Hampton was uniting the gangs, this, this, and that. And they took out Fred Hampton. And he was one of our best, most recent leaders who was really making tangible progress. He was flipping the stats. You know, and he wasn't telling people put down the guns. He was telling people to re-aim those guns, retarget. Don't stop the violence, redirect the violence. Target your true oppressor. Target your true enemy. Target the one who's profiting and sustaining these conditions. Instead of just being plantation bucks and exploiting other exploited people. And one thing we didn't understand about that whole COINTELPRO thing, COINTELPRO didn't just take black folks out of power. It didn't just remove revolutionaries from their agendas and dismantle organizations. COINTELPRO had a second agenda of erecting organizations and erecting leaders. So you have the elites that saying, well, in the post-World War II era, we had given certain concessions to the blacks, and we wanted to maintain the status quo. And we made certain allotments to them. And they weren't happy with it, Jim Crow and all that. So then we had the Civil Rights Bill. And then that proved not to be inadequate and very slow. And so then they started, instead of being integrationists, because remember, the militant movements grew out of the nonviolent integrationist movement. You had the SCLC, Student Nonviolent Coordinated Committee, SNCC, and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Who came out of those organizations? Kwame Ture, back then he was Stokely Carmichael, H. Rapp Brown, Bobby Seale. These are the founders. So the people who founded the militant organizations came out of the integrationist nonviolent organizations because they said, listen, we took them lumps on the head. We caught them bricks. We let the white people, the rednecks and the northern in Boston. And as again, if you south of the Canadian border, you south. This is not a race. The United States doesn't have racist regions. The entire nation is racist. And it's just racism manifests differently whether you're in an agricultural region versus an industrial region, a rural region versus a metropolitan region. Racism manifests differently, but it's just as intense. So you had, we followed the rules, basically. We do it, and Kwame Ture said the worst way to learn something, the slowest, most painful way to learn something is through trial and error. And that's how we did everything. And first we tried nonviolent integrationism. I got a call. Let me answer this call, and I'll come back to the point. Hello, caller. You're on the Bro Diallo Show. State your name and or alias. But that would kind of defeat the point of your alias. But state your name and or alias and where you're calling from. Brother Adolfo, what's up, my brother?
On this conversation that you're having about violence. Because it's pretty interesting because I was having a conversation with a detective in the Jackson Police Department a couple of days ago about the, I'm an attorney by training, so I just happened to be going over to the municipal court to check on something, and I came out and I saw this officer, and he usually speaks to me, and he asked me how I was doing and whatnot, and I was like, good, and I asked him how he was doing, and he said he was all right, and just out of impulse, I told him to stop locking up the people. And so we got into this conversation where he was talking about black people don't respect each other, black people, they so violent towards each other. Mm-hmm. And I was just telling him that first and foremost, we cannot even talk about black-on-black, so-called black-on-black violence until we talk about white-on-white violence and then white-on-black violence and the history behind all of this.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
So, of course, we had a disagreement. He's basically parroting what white folks say all the time, talking about how black people don't respect each other. And I was trying to get him to understand that, look, even the people that are shooting or stabbing each other in the streets of Jackson or Chicago or wherever the case may be, this is a small minority of the black community.
Exactly.
So I'm like, man, come on. You act like every black person is out here beating up on each other or shooting each other or stabbing each other or whatever the case may be. When the real culprit, and I told him, everybody want to talk about, we only talk about one kind of violence. We talk about interpersonal, person-on-person violence, physical violence at that. And I said, these white folks, they got a monopoly on violence. And y'all talk like black people got a monopoly on violence. We never talk about economic violence. We never talk about psychic violence. We never talk about ecological violence. And even interpersonal violence. Right. Physical violence. These people have a monopoly on that. They always have, all across the globe, right, and in the United States.
Right.
So I just feel that there needs to be a changing of narrative around violence, what constitutes violence, so people can get a real reality of what's going on and who is the real violent person in this world and in this society and who is causing the most violence. Wherever people are found. So, yeah, I just wanted to call and say that.
I really appreciate that because, I mean, actually my Friday show was going to be about the myth of white unity and just overall myths that black folks have about white folks. We have a lot of internal myths about, you know, how white people came to power and how they are able to sustain power. And you have a lot of African people who, from a large swath of our community to believe that whites are divinely inspired, they're more godly, hardworking, and willing to sacrifice, all the way to the point where, oh, whites are just unified. They stick together and we don't. You know? And so, yeah, I think a lot of our myths about white folks does two things. It discourages us from organizing against the systems and institutions, or even acknowledging that they're the world, the planet is under systems and institutions of global white domination. And then they say, well, many who acknowledge it says, well, what can you do about it? It's just so powerful. When the current system of world domination, as you were talking, the saturation of violence, as though even though it has innervated every element of existence and reality, it's extremely fragile. It's very fragile. So I totally agree with you that I think, as I said, what you were talking about is what's called in the sociology realm, descending violence. People at the top of the social hierarchy committing violence against people lower than them. And that is the most pervasive, and it's the most unseen. It is the least recognized and acknowledged because their violence is seen as legitimate, and that type of violence is defined as the violence that is needed to sustain society. If the police weren't here with their guns and their militarized weapons and their surveillance, there would be chaos. There would be anarchy. If the police weren't out here killing our kids, then our kids maybe raise up and be even more out of control, more violent. Remember the officer, the six officers that went up for trial? And that were acquitted.
Freddie Gray.
I'm sorry.
Talking about the Freddie Gray.
Yes, but I'm talking not about the brother, but the victim, but the six officers. The first officer that went on trial was a black policeman that had a strong reputation for assaulting and brutalizing black youth in the community. And when his first day of trial, there were several adult and elder members of the community that showed up to support him and to show the court that he had the black community's support. And when they were interviewed, they stated that those kind of tactics were what was needed to keep these niggas in check, basically. They didn't say it in the media, but that was basically what they were articulating. If they weren't here busting heads, if they weren't here snapping necks, if they weren't here shooting at the goons, then the goons would be even worse than what they are. So a lot of times we praise the violence coming from on high, as opposed to condemning and fighting it. Just change the narrative. We have to properly educate and fully educate our people, because I mean there's a lot of appropriate outrage, there's a lot of appropriate anger, but we have a severe scholarly and intellectual deficit, and revolution is a scholarly pursuit. There is not one successful revolution that did not have a very strong critical analysis tied to it. And you look at many of our decolonization struggles. These were highly educated individuals. And I don't mean formally educated. Many of them never set foot in a university. But these are people who spent hours studying. Not just studying black history. Not just studying. They studied the enemy. They studied the enemy's philosophies, ideologies, and methodologies. But you go to a meeting. Every time I go to somewhere, some organizational body, you always got the loudest voices or the people who know the least. I ain't about all this talking. We need action. What have you done? And it's like, well, I'm doing something right now. Educating our people is work, is valuable. No, what are you doing in the community? I mean, I went to organizations where people have told me, listen, we don't want you here because you just about all that talk. And despite, even though there's evidence of work, I mean, their anti-intellectualism, which is another thing I was going to get into, menticide, is one of the three main components of menticide. You know, and we'd rather just bust guns. To us, some of us, physical fighting is less painful than intellectual thinking. You know? So, I mean, we got work to do, but the work is being done, we could say. Brothers like yourself, you know, and I'm always impressed by the political and on-the-ground efforts going on in Mississippi, which is flyover country. We don't hear it. I know that also has an enormous amount of violence and gang activity, but, you know, there's a lot of brothers like yourself and Skip Coon down there making it happen. Even, you know, the God Box movement with David Banner. So, you know, we need to consolidate and intensify these movements, but we also have to acknowledge that they are active. Okay, I'll inbox you my number this afternoon. I'll inbox you all my contact info, so you can call me directly. Okay, all right, brother. I'll talk to you soon. I really appreciate your input, man, and your contributions are very valuable. All right, bro. Peace. What were you saying? What were you saying?
I said you could write down his number.
Oh, I'll just send him out. Okay. That was Brother Adolfo, one of our most consistent callers. I think I should put him on the payroll. And I'll give him twice as what I earn. So what's 2 times 0? Because the brother makes very valuable contributions to the show. You know, and I think that is another thing. A lot of our people have a very low opinion of our people. And I will quote myself again. I don't know the proper means of self-quoting. I don't know the Chicago-style annotation for self-quoting. But I say, in their effort to oppress and sustain the oppression of black people, whites have more black allies than enemies. And to me, even though I said it, I'm the first, but I'm sure others have said this in more eloquent ways, but that is a very, very profound statement. And that's something we really have to engage and really have to understand, is something we really need to promote. But, you know, back to what I was saying. I'm going to take it all the way back for the sake of time. We know about, and many of us know, we who care to know, we very much understand, and we always talk about how COINTELPRO and how they subverted. Well, let me just tie it into what I was saying. The militant organizations of the late 60s and 70s were a direct outgrowth of the integrationist nonviolent movements of the 50s and early 60s. And because the dream was deferred, the policy reforms and concessions were shown to be not sincere, that our enemies did not negotiate. What do you know? How would we have known that the oppressors, the elites, the oligarchs would sit across from us and negotiate agreements and not live up to the true ideas and intent of those agreements? How could we have known that? How could Dr. King and Abernathy and all the rest of them have known that? I don't know. Maybe they could have maybe talked to the Native Americans who had over 300 treaties. And this is something you really have to understand. The Native Americans signed over 300 major treaties of the First Nations. The Europeans, when they got here, there were dozens, if not hundreds, of nations. They took all these nations and said, of all these nations, we'll take the biggest, the five civilized tribes, the five nations, and we'll only acknowledge. Everybody else, we're just going to pretend like either get with the bigger tribes or you won't even be acknowledged as being here. We'll look at you like the beaver and the wolves and the buffalo. And the natives didn't speak the language. They were not a literate culture. They were an oral culture. So they couldn't even read the treaties. But in the Europeans, they were written in the European language, and they were written in a lopsided way to benefit the European invaders that we are now called settlers. But yet, the Europeans 100% of the times violated the treaties when the non-literate natives adhered to their end. That's what's going on with the Dakota Access Pipeline, which I'm avoiding talking about because that's another whole show. So if we had known, like, well, we've got the Civil Rights Bill. After 100 years, it was because we had a Civil Rights Bill 100 years ago. We had constitutional amendments 100 years ago that was supposed to solve the problems that we were fighting for 100 years later. But that's neither here nor there. But anyway, a significant amount of brothers got hip. And again, these were educated people. We like to look at the revolutionaries. We see the berets, we see the black fists, but we don't see many images of our revolutionary icons sitting in their dimly lit studies, reading Fanon, reading Marx, reading Sheikh Anta Diop, reading Albert Churchward. You know, we don't really see that. So we all think, well, oh, revolution is about the black fists and the berets and toting machine guns. But them same cats that were toting shotguns and machine gun in Oakland in the Black Panther Party were very astute. They were engaged in academic development before. I mean, heck, you just got to know what you're doing to read the manual for the doggone machine gun. And again, Bobby Seale, he was in engineering for the military. He was studying engineering. And he worked, they said he had some level of training with naval intelligence. Bobby Seale, law student. Kwame Ture, medical student. And I'm not saying you got to be a formal student. I'm just saying this anti-intellectual element of hip-hop, and then the few so-called scholars that we have, they seem to only try to go and mine our history for tidbits of facts and then run on Sonnetto TV and beat other so-called scholars over the head with that tidbit. Look at this tidbit. I'll smack you upside the head with my knowledge, and then you try to punch me in the gut with your... This is wrestling, worldwide wrestling. But they weren't studying to be the best scholar, to be the greatest scholar, to have the best... YouTube channel. They were studying because they wanted to implement these strategies. And if you look at their programs, even though I don't agree with their programs, you can tell they're academically based programs and policies. They're not just, I don't like this. We need to solve this problem. What are we going to do? We're going to fight. how, what, when, where, why, you know. So we know how these individuals were taken down. We went from integrationist, nonviolent to radical, militant, nationalist. And a lot of these same people were in both movements. They transitioned, or I say they developed, they evolved. They leveled up from one movement to the next. And so then they came COINTELPRO. And I just skipped over a lot of insights, but I'm trying to stay within some time parameters. And COINTELPRO was about, remember, we all know the line, to prevent the rise of a black messiah. And that was through subversion. You know, they'll monitor you and say, well, this guy has a mistress, this woman, she's abuses drugs. And through subversion, they try to delegitimize you. If delegitimizing you and eroding your following and your standing didn't work, then they took it to the next stage. They would try to convict you of a crime. They would try to set you up for a crime, which is how they did. First thing they would want to do was compromise you. They would say, listen, you're trending. People like you. You got people listening to you. What's the payoff? You can even continue your militant rhetoric. You can even continue to say, hey, down with the man, kill the white devil. But as far as these programs, no. You can give your people rhetoric. You can give your people hope. You can give your people dreams. But you cannot give them substantive programs. You cannot secure real resources. You cannot do anything that will threaten the status quo. So a lot of our so-called leaders, do I gotta say names? A lot of our so-called prominent leaders who talk the most dirt, who talk the most trash against the system and against the so-called white man and the piss and the devil, have not implemented or sustained any programs or are no threat to the status quo. In fact, a lot of these hate kill whitey leaders are in prominent positions in white institutions, receiving six-figure salaries, have secured millions of dollars in public contracts and grants from the Kellogg Foundation, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. That was the first thing. That was the soft sell. Because we were a threat, because the U.S. was dealing with multiple threats, and they had to neutralize these threats quickly. One of the main threats was communism and non-alignment movement and decolonization, the non-alignment movement, and the spread of communism and socialism. Those were the international threats. And then you had the internal threats. You had the American Indian movement, the black liberation struggle, and then you had the whole hippie movement, where they say hippies was just about free love and getting high. But no, you had the Weather Underground, you had the 70s Liberation Army, you had Latin America, you had Che Guevara and guerrilla uprisings, you had Oscar Romero, you had a lot of threats. But unlike a lot of our people, and a lot of our so-called black leaders, the Europeans didn't just say, white power, there was an element of that, a very serious and necessary element of propaganda, rhetoric, and motivation. But they also went to their scholars. They also went to you know, Kermit Roosevelt, B.F. Skinner, you know, and what's the other guy, Edward Bernays. They set up institutions and said, we've got to sit down and really, what's motivating this uprising? We know, okay, our oppression, racism, and that, but we've been engaged in colonization, enslavement, and racism for decades, but we haven't had this level of coordination and worldwide upheaval. What's behind all of this? And they sat and studied, and they say, okay, they had a plan for everybody. COINTELPRO wasn't just to take down the Black Panther Party. They instituted COINTELPRO. I told you the very, very first COINTELPRO was against the anarchists, the international workers of the world, back in the 1920s. And they did the same thing, assassination, exile, bad jacketing, all the same tactics. So they sat down, and what I want to do is, and I'm trying to get up to it. And again, I said, I'm sorry I have to go into all this context and backstory. But a lot of times I can't really assume that people know the history, so I could just give the analysis. Sometimes I have to give the history. And for a long time, J. Edgar Hoover, who was just a clerk in the OSS or OSA, the precursor to the FBI and CIA, he was just a clerk. He took down Garvey. And the same man that took down Garvey and his quitting was the exact same man that implemented the movement to take down Dr. King and Malcolm X. who was a gay man. And again, that's why I don't think that the gay rights movement, that you're going to have liberalization of gender, will mean somehow the larger society, the economy becomes more liberal, less racist, more accepting and opening. No, you can have openly pro-homosexual utopia and still have intensive racism. And there has never been any evidence presented to us, no peer-reviewed studies that showed that a persecuted white homosexual or a persecuted elite or wealthy gay person is more sensitive to the plight of other oppressed people. They might be hypersensitive to their own plight, but they will not give two defecations about what other people go through. And but we join these liberal movements and these liberalizing studies with the hopes that, well, this group suffers. Maybe they'll be able to be empathetic to our suffering as well, and we can unite. Nope. Sorry. And same things happened with the Jewish community. Jews were, but let's get back from that rabbit hole. And I want to talk about COINTELPRO and the side of COINTELPRO that we tend to overlook. So they decided the first step was, we'll integrate you. And we'll allow you to have your standing, your militant rhetoric, your the white man, the devil rhetoric, and we'll allow you to have all of that. We'll give you, in personally, some status, some comfort, some resources. But you can do keep all of the rhetoric you want, but no more programs, no more threats to the status quo. A lot of our leaders took that deal. If you didn't take that deal, step two in COINTELPRO was catch you in bed with the wrong person, catch you with a certain amount of money or funds or resources you had no business having, even if you were sincere, you know, to somehow show you as a flawed person, to show you as an unworthy or illegitimate leader, even though they knew that you were real, because which is the whole reason they're trying to delegitimize you, is because they saw you as a threat to the status quo, which is ultimately what we want from our leaders. And if they couldn't do that, then they would try to set you up for a crime. If your followers were like, yeah, okay, yeah, he had a little hanky-panky on the side, but we're not here for, we're not looking at him as a moral leader, we're looking at him as a strategic leader. He's helping us to progress. I mean, one of the greatest examples of that was Adam Clayton Powell, who was an extremely personally flawed man, but he was extremely effective at securing resources and power for his constituents. Another individual, Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali was an extremely personally flawed individual. But when it came to his contribution to the just aspirations of us as a collective, he was very effective. And not just using his pulpit, his status, his exposure to speak to our issues, but he also inspired a lot of other people. And even when they would show his flaws and show his shortcomings, people were like, we still love Ali. That's our brother. Flaws and all. So if they can't do that, then they will try to set you up for a crime, which is what they did with Ali. So we're going to criminalize you. If we can't delegitimize you, we will criminalize you. Geronimo Jijaka Pratt. I mean, I could go down the names, but I don't want to get too long because this is just a side note to my ultimate point. And then if they couldn't do that, then there's exile, Sister Ashada, Peter Neal. And then the ultimate sanction, which was a danger, because they didn't kill our leaders because they don't like our leaders. They when they kill, it's not out of emotion, it's out of strategy. Because they know a lot of times to kill a leader can sometimes turn that leader into a martyr and strengthen their cause. So a lot of times they like to try to tear you down before they take you out. Because if they kill you at the pinnacle, at the height of your popularity, and if we don't really recognize this history because we're too caught up in the fetishizing Dr. King, Dr. King was brought all the way down. Dr. King was abandoned by many of his supporters. When Dr. King stopped talking about civil rights and started getting on economic justice, when Dr. King stopped dealing with local internal racism and started dealing with international war crimes, a lot of black people abandoned King. We already know how Malcolm X was hounded, isolated, and excluded from his base of support when they killed him. But that's the ultimate step. Like, when they have to take you out, it's because they have exhausted all those other efforts. And that was the process of taking down our leaders. And some of us, we who care enough to know that about this. But they didn't just tear down leaders. As I alluded to in the first step, they erected leaders. The COINTEL program decided that black people want leaders. They want progress. They want to better their lives. Even you talk, I've talked to brothers convicted of serving life in jail, brothers convicted of homicides. I mean, there's certain fundamental ideas, no matter where you find, whether it's a Negro who don't really mess with the community too tough, or some brother in the trenches on the front lines of the struggle. There are certain fundamental things. They want a betterment for our people. They want to be unified. And a lot of people's like, I wish I didn't have to live like this. I wish I didn't have to do these things, but there's no other options. So as in the technology of control, beyond freedom and dignity, you have to give people the illusion, the appearance of progress, the illusion, the appearance of integration, the illusion, the appearance of opportunity, as this, at the same time you oppress them. And when that happens, the people begin to blame themselves for their conditions. We're poor not because of 2 centuries of economic warfare and subversion. We're poor because we buy Nikes and we're not willing to work hard. We're not miseducated and undereducated because of, again, 2 centuries of subversions. Because of a system of mass indoctrination has deemed black intellect a threat to the national security. So they implement and employ many strategies developed by very bright individuals to miseducate and de-educate us. That's not, we're poor because we don't value education like the Asians do. You know, and not to mention that a large swath of illiterate people in the world are Asian people. It is not a universal, but again, that's, again, stereotyping Asian people. And then that whole, you know, Asian super genius myth often really is a hamper to, and we got to deal with the Chinese century. We got to deal with the Chinese Revolution and its expansion into Africa, too. It's like, as I deal with one topic, it's like dozens of other topics that, and relevant issues. But, so, we just look at ourselves. We don't commit violence against each other because that's the byproduct of oppression. We commit violence because we're just violent people. We don't know how to get along. We hate each other. And why do we hate each other? Because we don't like each other. Why don't we like each other? Because we hate each other. You know, these looping things. And so when you try to say, well, I'm going to implement a program, and you've got this superficial, incomplete, inaccurate analysis of the condition, the programs, and Chicago is busting at the seams with programs. You can run out into the middle of the street butt naked, layered in syrup and ketchup, and say, I want to help black people. And people will throw money at you. Literally, there are people that I've interacted with that are not all there psychologically, and they have resources and support to implement programs to help other people. And I'm like, you need help. I've sat across from people at different events in different forums. And I'm not going to say no names, but I'm just telling you, Chicago... Again, as we said, as Amos Wilson said, look at who's profiting from these problems. These community development programs, these black organizations, there's so much people doing all this quote-unquote good work in Chicago, and the situation continues to decline. And I don't think there's anything insidious, but there's no, but number one, the system is not really going to fund a solution. Are they really going to pay you to take them down? And I talk to a lot of people that work on violence, and I'm like, you want to solve violence in South Chicago? The violence in Chicago doesn't start here. Why don't you go to the source? And how are you anti-violence, but you're not anti-capitalism? And in fact, you're trying to fight violence by integrating more black people into the capitalist economy, which is the source of global violence. So really what you're saying is not stop the violence. You're saying, you know, no, just do legitimate violence. Join the military. Join a multinational corporation. Come and work for the government that is engaged in 7 open war, illegal conflicts that violate the UN Charter, wars of aggression. Go get a government job. Get a good job and pay your taxes and fund the war machine. So that's not peace. That's pacification. And pacification, again, as we discussed days ago, a few shows ago, pacification is a military term. Another word that's synonymous is neutralizing. That's not peace. That's not healthy. And in fact, when you pacify a population or an individual, what you do is basically put a metal cap on a steam pot And it's going to explode with even greater violence, because that's what happened in the 60s. They pacified us with legislation. In the 70s, they pacified us with jobs. In the 80s, they pacified us with crack cocaine. In the 90s, they pacified us with the tech bubble and Bill Clinton's paper tiger economy. And as all that stuff imploded and collapsed on itself, the violence comes back even stronger. And I'm sure there's another pacification agenda in the pipeline, because it's all about the numbers. Forget this actual real world suffering. If we can get these homicide stats down, if we can get these violence stats down, if we can get Obama to reduce the prison population by superficial tokenism, like commuting sentences of people who should have been out of jail decades ago, and by canceling the contract, which can be at any moment renegotiated and reinstituted by Hillary Clinton, who is a racist and a supreme mass incarcerator. You know, she was mass incarcerating while, you know, Obama was cramming for finals at Harvard. And she is a true OG. Like I said, she's really sick now. Pray for our Democratic nominee, because she's sick. And I ain't saying what to pray for. I'm just saying do the prayers. But you decide what you want to pray for. So, now we have a lot of leaders in our community as a result of the COINTELPRO program. They got militant rhetoric. They got sincere aspirations. But they are extremely ineffective. And again, I'm not trying to tear people down. Because if you try to, because me, progress is progress. And I think, I define our struggle as multi-generational. So I'm not looking for, okay, you started this 2 months ago, why ain't we free yet? I have a very long trajectory. You know, so I expect this struggle it was here before I got here, and I intend for it to be ongoing long after I've passed on or retired to play Xbox and eat peanut butter cups and stop even thinking about this stuff. But I think I got at least a couple of more decades in the game, at least. Being a vegan, maybe 3 or 4 more decades before I can retire to Xbox and peanut butter cups. So, but a lot of times, even with the Black Panther's 10-point program, I'm saying I would look at people's agendas and say, if you got everything you wanted, if every concession, every reform, every policy that you're fighting for was implemented, it wouldn't address the core of the problem. Multinational corporations would be, the mass poverty, the unemployment, and the deaths in Haiti, the deaths in Congo, the deaths in South Sudan, the deaths in Honduras would still be ongoing. It's too limited. And there's an old saying I got from a really corny movie in the 80s. If you're going to be a bear, be a grizzly. If you're going to try to fight for justice, go for the whole enchilada. You know, because, I mean, history tells us, hey, you're not even going to get the minor stuff. So you might as well ask for the world. And if you get 10% of what, if you get 10% of nothing, you got nothing. If you ask for everything and you only get 5%, you've made progress. But a lot of our leaders are consciously or unconsciously COINTELPRO leaders. Because if I had to have an enemy, and I'm allowed to not only handpick who the leaders of my enemies are, and then I will be able to fund, which means focus and refocus and determine the direction of that thing, I mean, how can I lose? So our organizations need independent funding. Our organizations need to be aggressively ridiculed. No organization should be, how would you say, venerated or worshipped. No individual leader, a leadership in the Black community should be the worst job in the community. It shouldn't be the cushiest job. It should be a job that nobody would want unless they absolutely were sincere. You know, it shouldn't be saying, hey, I can get the leaders, I get the women, I get the comforts, I get the money, I get the status, and nobody can question me or else they're called a hater. Or else my goons will show up at their doorstep and harass them, if not worse. Leaders, to be a Black leader, especially, and I'm talking strictly about the liberation struggle. I ain't talking because there's all kind of other Black people doing all kind of other things and got all kind of other leaders. I'm not talking about these new Negro organizations. I'm not talking about the religious leaders. I'm not talking about the frat leaders. I'm talking about the Black people who have stated that they want Black liberation and empowerment and unification. And there are or black people and black organizations that don't even pretend that, and y'all on some next stuff, and, you know, y'all do y'all. Every brother ain't a brother. But for the black people who give lip service to or truly believe that they want liberation, we have to make sure that our leadership, because as a result of COINTELPRO, we can't always, even the most militant, even the most Melania Karengas, sorry, I didn't mean to say that, people who got the strongest voice. And it's not just in the United States. Remember the scholar Chinwezu said, if you look at the decolonization struggle, the Africans who got up on the tallest podium and screamed, Africa free, free Africa, the loudest, were the biggest sellouts. Jomo Kenyatta. Jomo Kenyatta came to power. He didn't institute land reform. Mobutu. Who was more African than Mobutu? Joseph was his real name, but he changed his name to Mobutu Sese Seko because he had an African awakening. And at the same time, he was talking about black nationalism, get the white man out, and all that. At the same time he was running down all that game, he was robbing Africa for billions. They once stopped his wife at an airport in Europe. I think it was in, it was either in Switzerland or the UK. And she just had like like 5 million in a couple of bags. And she wasn't even carrying the bags. Her servants were carrying the bags. Robin Africa blind. And remember he had the rumble in the jungle. He brought Muhammad Ali and George Foreman there and all these affluent, progressive black folks who were the leaders of black. And they all went to Africa for this major festival, this major display of black progress and black power and that we could do it ourselves. And nobody talks about how Mobutu held Muhammad Ali and his whole team at gunpoint and Fred George Foreman. They got the payoff. Nobody talks. That whole rumble in the jungle thing. I mean, I really like that documentary, We Were Kings, but it don't tell the whole story. So we're too quick to rally behind some good rhetoric, some rally behind excellent oratory skills. But we don't sit down and say, okay, how long have you been active? What is your particular area of focus? Where is your region or area of operation? What is your specific strategic plan? How much resources, material, money, facilities, how much material resources do you need? How much of that do you currently have? And what's your plan for acquiring the additional resources? What is your contingency for when you provoke or catch the eye of the local authorities or national or international bodies, subversive organizations? When the hitman, economic hitman, the jackals, or even the Marines show up at your door, the feds. We don't ask these questions of our leader. All you gotta do is jump up and say, justice or else, and we all repeat, justice or else, and then we go back. We go out and do die-ins, we blocking highways. And I'm not against any of these actions, and Lord knows, everybody knows, I'm sure there's people listening to me now in Chicago is like, I see you at these things. I've seen you at the rallies. I've seen you at these things. I've seen you, you know, I went and marched around City Hall with the teachers union. Yes, I engage in protest. But to me, that is not the movement. That is an element of the movement. That is the element of the struggle. But we need to ask, get sober. We need to sober up. We need to stop being drunk off of how our melanin popping, black girl magic, getting drunk off of how beautiful, how we jump, flipped and swam for gold and, you know, black excellence and the next black kid that in the next couple of months we're going to celebrate the next black polymath, ultra genius who graduated with a 5.0 and accepted to all the major Ivy League schools. And we're going to celebrate that and share that link all over social media without ever asking the question, what is he going off to learn? And then how will he apply that grade? Who is he going to sell his great intellect to? And are we even in the bidding? Do we even get in the room when this guy graduates and goes on to do the work? Are we even considered? Does he even say, no, I ain't working for Bechtel. I ain't working for Halliburton. I ain't working for the government. I ain't working for Konnichiwa Industries. I'm going right back to the hood. I hope y'all got some food, clothing, shelter, at least for me, at least can sustain me as I use my massive intellect on behalf of my people. Or I'm going to work in Ghana. I'm going to work in the Sahel region. I'm going to work in the Niger Delta. I'm going to help rebuild Zaire. I'm going to, or the Congo. Right? See, I can't even talk about, I got Mobutu on the brain. I'm going to Zimbabwe and sit on the as a minister in the Mugabe government. No. We send our best and brightest off, and we put them on a silver platter. We glaze their back, their butts, and put an apple in their mouth and hand them over to our enemies. Like, look at this brilliant slab of meat for you to have your way with. And people say I'm anti-education. But I'm saying we need to get serious because our enemies and our oppressors are serious. They're well studied and they're well prepared. And they've demonstrated to us time and time again. We're not only willing to kill you to maintain our position, we're willing to send our children en masse to die in order to maintain their systems and institutions of oppression and capitalism. They will throw these ill-fitting helmets and ill-fitting boots on their own children and send them off to die in foreign lands that their kids can't pronounce. And that's the thing. And I'm kind of spilling over into tomorrow's show. You know, you pack up a boat of black folks and send them off somewhere and the boat don't come back. And one African looks at the nest and says, what happened to that boat we sent east? Boat we sent east never went. So it was like, okay, no more boats going east, you know. But, you know, the Europeans send a boat east and it don't come back. Hey, old chap, what happened to the boat we sent east? Didn't come back. Then send two boats. The two boats didn't send three boats. You know, they like, see murder, I'm ready to die for mine. They're ready to die for theirs. They're well ready to kill for theirs. And they pretty much at a position now that if they can't have the world, no one can have it. And with facing those odds, I mean, and they got some, again, that's why we got to talk about the myth of the myth of white unity. We got to discuss that because we have a lot of illusions about our oppression. And the only thing more dangerous about illusions about self, internal delusions, are illusions about your oppressors or your enemies, your enslavers. You know, because a lot of times the most dangerous illusion about your enemy is that your enemy isn't your enemy. So, what all that got to do with Chicago violence? Number one, in Chicago, there are a lot of entrenched, powerful interests that profit directly from the massive homicides and the overall dysfunction of South Chicago. Everything from real estate values to investment, million and billion dollar investments. Chicago right now is, they're arguing, saying that Rahm Emanuel is the mayor of downtown. And you, if you ever travel downtown, you ever take the lakeshore, you ever take the West Highway, all you see are cranes. All you see are construction, highway expansion. And people are arguing, well, why are you, and one of the major, one of the mayoral candidates in the most recent election that Chewy just surrendered, Chewy didn't want to win that election. Chewy got no plan. Chewy had a plan. Chewy's plan was, I don't want to win this. This is a dog and pony show. I'm part of the Democratic establishment, and I don't want to piss off my bosses. That's a pretend democracy. Like, when you go to see World Wrestling, you don't want to just see Hulk Hogan turn cartwheels in the ring. You have to put somebody in there with Hulk Hogan to beat up on. Even though we know Hulk Hogan's going to win, we still want to be entertained. That's what they did with Chewy. But anyway, the mayor said, we want to expand the progress and investment that we see downtown towards other parts in the north side and the west side. We want to send that to Inglewood and the other blighted neighborhoods. It's only fair. These are citizens. These are community members. These are taxpayers. So when you say, well, there's violence, these areas are plagued by violence. So it's not because we're racist we don't invest in black areas. It's just not practical. Until we can decrease the violence. How do you decrease the violence? By displacing the violent. How do you define? Who are the violent? Black people. Get the blacks out. And every year consistently over the last half decade, every population demographic in the city of Chicago, Asians, Jews, whites, let me move on. White folks. And other, I don't know who other are, aliens, or maybe those are the reptilian overlords, the 3-4% that make up others, Hispanics. Every demographic, every ethnic group in Chicago has expanded, except for black people. We are contracting, which means we're hemorrhaging. Black folks are fleeing. And guess what? How? And we talk about the Great Migration. Black folks occupied some of the most pristine, unpolluted, and productive real estate at the turn of the century. In the late 1800s, early 1900s, black people were stuck on some of the most pristine land. And we worked hard to secure deeds to some of that land. And what happened? And I'm going to have to play this. I found an audio of this article that they took the land that pretty much describes how they stole trillions of dollars. We ain't poor because we spend too much money on bundles and Jordans. We're poor because this system, through its public policy and economic policies, has stolen trillions of dollars of wealth from the black community, from black individuals and us collectively. That's the source of our poverty. It's theft. White on black crime. That's the source of black poverty. Because if hating your own people, committing violence against your own people, being corrupt, being anti-intellectual, if being committing crimes was the source of poverty, then the white elites would be the poorest population because they commit the most crime, they provoke the most violence, and they are the most corrupt population. The number one form of theft in this country is wage theft. If there was a truly a just society, then the Waltons are the biggest, not only are the Waltons the biggest thieves in the country, this is the family that owns the controlling stake in Walmart, the number one employer in the nation. Formerly the biggest corporation, it was surpassed by Apple some time ago. But they would be, if all the ideas that we have about what makes you rich and worthy of being rich were true, then the Walton family would be an impoverished and incarcerated. They are the biggest thieves in the country, and they are the number one welfare recipients in the country. You know, so everything we're taught about, and I think the criminal element in our hood understands that, cynically. That you know, it's a lie. Hard work will help you to progress under capitalism. I'm past the break. I hope I made a point. Maybe you can, you know, take all that stuff and put it together and make a coaching point. But I'm sure Sister Nicole's going to tell me, what was you talking about today? Let's take a brief musical break, come back for the closeout. I'm going to pick off here. Maybe I shouldn't. I should just leave this alone. This is too big to tackle. But tomorrow I'm going to start off with specific acts from tomorrow. After you, tomorrow, from one step to the next, what specifically needs to be done to reduce, truly reduce violence? And I don't just mean the violence of the street. I mean violence overall. To have a more peaceful community, you need a more peaceful world. And if you're on some forget everybody else, I'm just worried about my hood, then you're not worthy of peace. So, again, let's take a musical break. Shout out to all the activists who might have offended. You know, I still consider myself your ally, even if you don't consider me. Shout out to y'all. And again, as Dale Jones would say, to excuse his horrible things he said about people, this is criticism with affection. Blitz the ambassador.
Stop saying tomorrow. You're not
going to
be
here.
You're not going to be on the air tomorrow.
Oh, I said tomorrow? The only time I exist is when I'm on the air. I say tomorrow because Thursday doesn't exist to me. Yeah. Why? I just want to see. I don't know if there's a time limit for it. Are you going to get on?